I just sent you another email with a translation of a poem and a picture illustrate that poem. And also I sent you a link. I'm going to share that link in the class anyway, with a pic of the 12 landscape scrolls. So that before I forgot recording, I should put recording on. Let me see. Stop. Record. Okay. It's a ping. Ping. Let me see. So ping is not on yet. I'll wait for ping to come. She contributed the photo I sent you last night with the ox.
Henry?
Yes.
No. Henry?
Yeah.
Henry Lee?
Oh, Henry Lee.
Henry?
Yes.
Henry Lee.
Charlie? Do you have a...
I can't pin
history?
Him.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so Ping is here. Let me make you a co-host today. So you can share anything you like to share with us.
Oh, no wonder.
To the pictures you shared with me last night, or everybody last night. Okay, so shall we start? It's 9:30 now. So it's being recorded, so if anybody come late, they have a chance to review. Okay, today we're very excited to have a co-host from our class, Ping Huang. Can you say hi to everybody? Let me.
Hello, everyone.
Let me lift my my spotlight so you can your image can be seen. I'm sorry, it's a little bit different. Let me see. How do I lift myself? I can make you a coast about like withdraw code to make a coast replace. Okay, I can focus on you. Trust me. several years ago, Ping has sent me a book with her mother's paintings. The paintings of Guo Xiu Yi. I was really impressed. I became immediately a fan of this woman artist in contemporary Chinese history.
Henry, we can't see you.
Oh, I'm sorry. Should I make a call? Let me see. I want to also spotlight me.
We see Ping.
Oh, yeah.
Hi, everyone.
Got a review. Let me see. Add the spotlight. Okay, here we go. Right. So you can see both of us. Yeah. So Ping has shared this beautiful book, and you can still get today on Amazon, right? It's available on Amazon.
Yes, it is on Amazon.
Yeah, the Chinese title reads "Qi Bai Shi Nü Di Zi." Qi Bai Shi is a woman disciple, right? a student. Guo Xiuyi Hua Ce, the paintings of Guo Xiuyi. Visual Press, USA. So thank you for sharing this book with me. And this is her mother's picture. You can see you look very much like your mother. Yeah, we can immediately recognize. We have a picture of your mother with Qi Baishi. Can you tell us her learning experience?
Hi, yeah. My mother was a very active woman, right? She is intelligent and have big heart. In 1930s, my father was a general fighting the Japanese war, fighting the Japanese invasion. After the World War II, my father was rewarded by American President Henry Truman with Medal of Freedom. My mother was with him to supporting the soldiers and help wounded. In 1938, my mom with Madame Song Meiling and others found the orphanage for the war children, which lost their parents in the war. In their effort, they saved and educated more than 30,000 orphans. After the 1949, the war ended. So my mother is trying to see some other things will more suitable for her. One day, my mother and her friend visited Chibai.
Come on, you need to come past.
Oh, my mother would buy Chi's painting, and she became Chi's disciple immediately. And Chi also admired my mother's talent, and he inscribed a lot of my mother's painting, more than I think 50 of them. It's not usual if a teacher inscribed your painting, which means great honor. Like the one, I don't know how I show this.
You want to share screen? Henry? Yeah, you can do that.
Okay. So yeah, how about page 16, let's say, okay. Just that cow with landscape,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Here is my mother's painting. Since we are talking about the landscape, let's talk about this one. This one is she studied Chi's painting and memorized it. And then she painted. And Chi had inscription on this painting. She said, Xiu Yi studied my painting by memory. Great stroke. She can paint landscape in the future. Noted by Chi at age 92.
Mm-hmm.
Things like that. A lot of them, like page 13. Henry, if you can turn your book.
Mm-hmm. This is
this rooster, the rooster, right? The rooster.
Yeah.
Okay. And Chi wrote a rooster in the morning on this painting. Chi wrote that Xiu Yi's painting is as brilliant as mine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. And at page 31, the lotus.
I cannot tell if this is your mother's painting or Qi Baishi's painting. Sometimes I feel it's better even.
Yeah, she is brilliant, yes. And on this painting, which is the last lotus leaf in autumn rain, she wrote, "My disciple Xiu Yi is quite accomplished in the art of painting." So such things, you know, my mom was one of best Qi's student, and she captured the Qi of Qi Baishi.
Yeah.
Right, Henry? Yeah. That's what I think, right?
And, right. Her brush strokes is as great as the master, and her composition is so harmonious. I cannot say anything that's short of an achievement as Qi Baishi did. Thank you. If you have any.
And also, I want to make a point is that she only started on her age 40. So, which, you know, she was not an artist, and she was not trained in the art field. And that inspired me as well. So I didn't get a chance to learn from her or do any painting. But I started to learning from Henry and starting, you know, after I retire, after my 60 years old. Yeah.
Okay, it's never too late to learn. So she was...
That's the lesson.
A mother of three, right?
No, I don't have a child.
You're just one? Okay. I mean, not you. Your mother was a mother of.
My mother have. I have three brother and one sister.
So you have four siblings.
I have three brother and one sister.
Three brother, yeah. So she was a mother when she studied with Qi Baishi, right?
Huh? I'm sorry.
She was a mother already of four when she studied with Master Xi.
Yeah.
I was born 2 years after Qi Baishi passed, I think. So I didn't have chance to, anyway, you didn't have chance to meet her, meet him, but through your mother, we can all learn through this.
Maybe when I was very little, I don't remember anything.
You probably have met Qi Baishi.
Yeah, probably, because it's very close, right?
Yeah, and, yeah. Your family is very close. And I like to share the story that your parents are a major collector of Qi Baishi's masterpieces, right? They had that piece, the page 31, right? The ox one was still in your possession or auctioned? Do you still have, your family still had that picture? Or I think I read in the article you sent me that painting was $1 million, right? That page 13, yeah, page 16. So this painting was auctioned for $1 million.
Or no, because this, I don't know, if you want, you can talk about the story, right?
Yeah, is this, the authentic one is still in your family possession or auction?
No longer, unfortunately.
Yeah. It's in the market, right, yeah. Let me share the original. So this painting was a copy of original painting Qi Baishi painted for your father. Was it right? Let me share that one so we can compare the two, okay? And then you tell us the story about this in the news or in the online social network. Okay, okay, let me just put the two of them together so we can compare the two and see how talented your mother was. Why Xi Bai Shi inscribed with the saying on the picture that your mother is so great with the landscape, talented. And so let me open this. Oops. And I'm going to share this with you. Okay, now we are seeing two pictures. Without telling you the story, you can unmute yourself and tell us which one was Qi Bai Shi's painting, which one was a copy of the master. I think probably we already see that, so the answer is obvious, right? And what's the difference between the two? Anybody? What's the major difference? And then maybe Huang Pingwat shared the story if they cannot tell. Can you tell the difference between the two? Anybody?
One is more colorful.
Okay. Yeah, that's a very, very different
The detail on Ping's mother's painting is much more, there's much more detail, like on the mountains in the background.
That
too. On the contours, she seems to have emphasized that.
Mm-hmm.
There seems to be much more energy in her painting.
Yeah, more vibrant, I agree.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, other difference? Did we miss anything?
I see in her painting, there's ombre, more colorful and more vitality. Vitality. Yeah.
Yeah, this has been mentioned, I think.
Yeah, very nice.
Okay, Ping, do you want to share the story now about the kid?
Yeah.
The primary school kid.
When I saw this at the beginning, I didn't see any difference. Okay, yes, I agree with you. I saw my mother's, it's more colorful, it's more contrast. I think it's more pop into your eyes. That's what I saw. Until one day I saw an article, you know, it says elementary students, just ask a question on these two paintings. She asked why there are shade in one and there's shade in the other.
I think the teacher, the primary school art teacher was introducing this painting by Qi Bai Shi, the original one, to her students. So the primary school student pointed out something was wrong in this painting. I think that was the story, right? Without knowing your mother's version, I think in the article, the author discovered the existence of your mother's copy and added the discussion. So the question was to the teacher, why there was no reflection in the water, right? Why there was no reflection? Yeah, something was wrong. So it become a topic on social network among adults, actually. So maybe the teacher asked her friends or somewhere because it became a debate on social network. Someone argued that they must be overcast day or, you know, the mud, the the ox made the mud very, very muddy. So there's no reflection or something like that. But someone argued that it was not true and even found a photograph, a real photograph of an ox plowing in the rice field. And it does have a vague kind of reflection in the water. So
yeah, and also one article says you see the peasant wear a raincoat, right?
Raincoat
and
jacket.
And there's a raincoat or a rain jacket, whatever it's called.
Yeah, that's very,
cow,
very
right?
Fresh. Yeah, I never saw this jacket, rain jacket on raincoat on ox before. I think probably, when I had our dog, the dog has this kind of jacket when it was raining. So I totally think it's possible. So it's a raining day. So we, on many of Chibashi's paintings, he does the remote mountain in orange color, which indicates a sunny day. So this is overcast day. So when we copy, if we decide to do this, we should not use the orange color to, to paint the sunshine, right? So we should keep it cool. Yeah, that's a good point.
So there are many arguments. So by that argument, some people say, because of the rain jacket, there shouldn't be any reflection in the water, right? So whatever, but I think what I think is the Chinese painting is not emphasized on reflection. That's when I first saw the article, I replied to my friend, that's what I think. And then I saw many articles regarding this subject. I thought there are just some people wanted to get the fame by analyzing this painting, right? But I think it's a funny and it's an interesting story. And some people ask me, so do you think with the reflection it's better or the other one is better? I think it doesn't matter. Added reflection is nothing wrong. It's okay. But without reflection, it's good as well. That's what my take.
Yeah, I agree with you. So even our class, nobody has pointed out the difference, you see? So even we see the reflection, our eye just our mind just filter it out. Just like when I show my dog in front of a mirror, he immediately turned off his head. He doesn't want to, to see himself in the mirror. Same idea. Our minds think something is elusive, not important. But in Western painting, like a cast shadow, reflection is a must to indicate lighting. Elusive reality. So that's a major difference between Western and Eastern painting approach. I think in other occasions, I did see a reflection of a lotus flower. I didn't research on this before the class, if you are interested, I can show you that. Chibashi did paint a lotus reflection in the water. And he painted the little fish, not fish, the little baby frog, what they call the what's that? We painted that before. The baby frogs. Yeah. So
tadpoles.
He painted those swimming around the reflection of a flower. So scientifically, the fish or the frog in the water cannot really see the reflection, right? But Chibashi did that. So Chibashi has a lot of play of psychological reality, human reality, human, the thought, the feeling, not the science. So if the reflection does not create any addition of interest, artistic interest, ignore that. So you don't paint everything you see in reality, right? That's the lesson we learned. But Ping's mother is very, you can see, although she memorized the composition and the strokes, but she did made it more colorful and more realistic in the sense of color and reflections in the water. So we should appreciate that. If you like, we can, if you copy, you know, you can try on either with the reflection or not. But
yeah,
that's
I think the Chinese spontaneous painting is more like an impressionist, right? I don't think you capture a very detail, but you carry the essence of the scene you're seeing to express yourself more. That's why I like it, but I feel it's kind of hard for me to do it.
Yeah, for me, I noticed some other detailed difference. For example, on the original painting on the left, on the right, I can see the bridge has a connected to two side of the water, whatever. And I see this green on the right is a flat platform. So instead of like a top of the hill, on your mother's painting, she didn't really read carefully, I think. So because this is part of the road, it could be a road, end of a road, and then you connect to the bridge. It's a relatively flat surface. And the Baishi didn't make it, make the hill behind as a tall mountain. So if you put white clouds like your mother did under the hill, it makes it feel like a very high mountain, you know? And then the white could be water also, could be, so it I think Baishi makes more sense to me because he softened the edge between the hill and the road, but that's very clear. The logic is very clear. That's just a pass towards the bridge, and then the mountain is just the roadside, not very far away. So there's no. Although it's a rainy day, I don't think you see white clouds. Mist is a different thing. You can do mist. Mist doesn't have a shape, like a, you know, really far away. So this shouldn't be a very far away mountain because the bridge is relatively close. Usually when Baishi does the bridge, he does it with one stroke without the top plane. You know, I can show you more of this kind of painting. Anyway, let's go ahead to see the major collection of your parents, and they set the world records for Chinese painting on in the market. I think I sent you guys a link, and probably you didn't get that before the class. Let me open that for you. I have to go to my email myself. This is different computer. Okay.
Ping, what is the title of your mother's book? And how do you spell her name?
Guo Xiuyi.
Guo Xiuyi. Yeah, maybe you can type in the chat.
Okay, I will put into the chat. Okay. I'll take a photo of it and then hold on.
Okay, let me share just maybe 5 minutes. We'll watch this together. I want to show the best landscape painting, and we'll talk about the landscape painting by Baishi. Why it's so valuable, treasurable. Okay. Here. sound. Okay. Yeah, let me play this.
Oh, goodness, goodness.
I'll skip the beginning. Okay. It has a English subtitles, so I'm not going to translate. You can read.
我一直很关注咱们节目，然后看了很多咱们做的西方经典艺术大师。今天呢，主要是让你们一睹咱们中国人自己艺术大师的作品。这件作品呢，是目前在中国艺术市场上流通的价值最高的一件作品，
甚至是世界艺术史上最重要的一件中国人的作品。
我终于看到这件传世巨作，齐白石《山水十二条屏》。
宽47高1.8米，这构图气势大。12幅作品一字排开，甚至要站到20米开外才能把它们全部拍下来。这个时候，问题来了，这画该怎么看呢？齐白石这花鸟画是他一生创作作品最多的。山水、贝叶、草中人物都是在他的作品里是相对少的。
尤其这十二大条在一生创作的山水画中的重中之重，可以说是流传在市场上具有唯一性的。最早人们画山水是因为交通不便利，一辈子走不了多远，但是呢又很想要去感受大自然，所以就把这些山水都画下来挂在家里，哪怕躺着看也能感觉自己好像徜徉，这就是宗炳所说的墨影。我觉得山水画最难的一个原因在于，画家胸中是要有意境的。
所以阅历越深，画就越有内容。每一个景儿都是他舞出舞归，在路上、生活中得到感触而记忆下来的。就像是一个武林高手，问鼎江湖之前，必先通识先贤，精通各派武功。齐白石如果70岁过世，根本就没有东西。他最好的东西全部在70岁，80岁简直不得了，90岁以后炉火纯青。
这十二条屏里继承了米芾的山水画法、董其昌的山水画法、石涛的山水画法，继承了金农的山水画法，
集各家所长，贯通任督二脉。这个水的画法是齐白石独创的，
画之前用水把这纸喷一下，然后笔蘸着淡墨这么一层一层一刷，染出来的，是一种在似已不似之间的效果，需要你回味的效果。
在推陈出新，开创独门秘籍。你在看这荷花，层层点点，从荷叶到荷花都有颜色的变化，都有大小的变化。听荷香，仿佛荷花不但有香气，还有声音，给你创造了一个很雅的环境。在这很雅的环境中住的人是高人。
一朝一世皆有章可循，有千变万化。最后不见其人，但闻其声，刀剑化于无形。中国画的语言的灵魂是中国的国学。不懂中国的国学，你领悟不到它的美感在哪儿。
一件伟大的作品要过来其实很难，因为谁都知道它很珍贵，藏家也知道，藏家也不愿意卖。在99年呢，我碰到了那个十二条屏的藏家，从99年到2015年，可以说努力了10多年。那时候我想买它的，他是那时候没同意买。后来又到了11年的春季，齐白石的。 有一个松蝇图卖了4.3亿，我就打电话给这个藏家，我说齐白石起来了。这个藏家呢，犹豫了一天以后就说家里面不想去动这个齐白石山水十二条屏，因为我们是10周年，
因为是好朋友，所以今年呢，还是一致同意呢，委托给保利拍卖。
原作者已经离世，摆在面前最大的一个问题就是，这画是真的吗？
市场上拍了30000多件齐白石，真迹大概1000张左右，95%以上都是假的。这东西流传有序，考证有据，既有文字资料，又有影像资料。在1955年10月5号，中央新闻纪录电影制片厂给他拍了一个纪录片，叫《画家齐白石》。
他画的都是我们非常熟悉的祖国的景色。他描写过那些黄昏的渔村，描写过秋天的枫树林。
流传有序、考证有据的东西，就可以向世人宣告：第一，它是真的。第二，他是在该作家的作品中有非常重要的位置。
保利拍卖经历的10年，也是中国艺术品经历的10年，从来没有这么贵的东西在市场中呢进行询价或者进行展览。我希望中国最重要的文化的传承能够传到最辉煌、最火爆的行业，非常棒。
站在这个天价拍品面前，我其实是非常谦卑和怯懦的，可能真的要等我们有了足够的阅历、足够的内涵和足够的文学底蕴之后，我们回过来再来看这幅画，又会有不一样的感觉。我相信那个时候我们和白石老人之间一定会有更多心灵上的共鸣。
Stop this. Okay, the result of this auction was over $1 billion. That set the records. It's 2 years ago. So today we're going to do some painting. We have too many options. What do you have any final, any comments about the 12 landscape scrolls?
Yeah, I like the video, but it's not very clear, right? So.
You mean to see the details of those works?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Okay. I just want to, because I sent the high resolution pictures. I do have high resolution pictures. Maybe you have to share with us, right? On my computer, I can share with you. And we can share the details of that somehow.
I learned something, you know. I don't know, you know. I really didn't quite understand Qi Baishi's landscaping until I see the video and the article you sent yesterday.
Oh yeah, let me go through some of the 12 and we can look at some details maybe. Okay, I can share the, let me share the screen maybe. Share the screen, I think I got high resolution ones. There are so many different versions. Let me find the good one. Let me see if this one good enough. I think it's probably enough. Okay. We want to read a little more before we paint. That's a good idea, I think. Always. Let's review the good Qi Baishi. The authentic one, this is definitely authentic because it's all, you know, as mentioned in the video, and you know that because it was in your home for almost 40 years, right? before it was sold to a collector in Taiwan, and then recently they resold it. So let me share with you guys. So there's too many forced or faked work. Through this practice, I want you to develop the eye to appreciate Xi Baishi's authentic painting, so you can tell the difference. So after this 12 paintings, I will show you a faked one, or not a faked one. You can tell if it's faked or not. Okay.
Yeah, so Henry, I feel that's helpful. Just the compare. Okay.
So you can really see the difference, right? So this is a night view of a landscape with the moon. He did this repeatedly with the two rocks. And when we deal with this kind of composition, it's hard to break the equilibrium, what you call this two sides should not be the same, right? So he has ways to do that, make one. I saw many versions of this, and I think also many copies are faked ones, but this is a good one, a good example of this. This is a river scene with kind of a willow, maybe some, we call this a cypress. But anyway, it's kind of, you can see the bridge. I mentioned just the three strokes or four strokes. So usually he does the bridge like that. So the bridge with the ox was quite close to the, this one is actually close to the viewer, but he also does it to just like writing a symbol. So his landscape is very highly symbolized, just like symbols, not realistic at all. Yeah, because he studied the vocabularies of Chinese landscape through Mustard Seed Garden Manual of Painting. He didn't really study under any master or in the school. He taught himself. And he traveled in his mid-age five times around the country. And his painting is, his landscape painting basically from his memory of home and his traveling. He paints the mountain mainly based on his impression of Guilin, Li River. We did that with the Master Xu's painting, right? Li Jiang, the Li River, with this monolithic kind of peak. There's a peak called the Du Xiu Feng, monolithic, beautiful mountain. I have a picture of that, actually. I can show you. So his landscape is basically inspired by Guilin, he used many Fuhao kind of symbols from the Mustard Seed Garden Manual of Painting. The characteristic of his landscape is this: he does the houses very well, just like writing, Zhuanshu, the seal script. And his brushwork is so firm, and usually it's a tip concealed, right? He used the center stroke, and he never repeat when he draws something. He rarely used mustards, except on these trees. They are not mustards, right? On the rocks. His ground is usually painted with color without a contour, and his distant mountains have no ink contour either. This is a very come on theme he repeated many times with the willow or pine in the horizon against the sunset sky. It's very dramatic. And his river is usually drawn, like I think we learned this, like in Jizuyan, the master seed garden menu. He drew these waves. This is sunset. And he also does sunrise. I have a collection, a photo with our sunset, our sunrise. We did sunset, sunrise last time. We can see how Chibashi make it. It's so simple. If you think it's landscape is too complicated, look at Chibashi, how simple it is. You know, try to make a simple statement like this. So here's a space. Here's his use of empty space. Yeah. This is, he never fuss with pine trees unless it's a flower and the birds painting, you know, with the eagle or something standing on the pine. He always does the pine trees like some critics says toothbrush. Does it? Like toothbrush. Okay. Yeah, if you see toothbrush pine, in a painting, that doesn't mean this is not done by a master, okay? But it has a rhythm, it's so natural, you know? It's a, he painted very slowly, all the strokes, very calligraphic. He does pi ma chun this way, you know? The hemp fiber, right? You could recognize that. He does learn a lot from Qing Dynasty masters and then like four, but he never copied them. He wants to learn directly from his life experience, but not from ancient, just copy others' composition. So he hardly make landscape to sell. He usually gave it to good friend. This set was originally given to a life-saving doctor who saved his life after like a week of unconsciousness. He was saved by this Chinese traditional medicine doctor named Chen Yuling or something. He painted this as a thank you gift to the doctor. Later was acquired by Ping's parents in 1949. Yeah. Okay. So this was the painting talked in the video. This kind of water is a very misty water, you know, like clouds depicting the heavy fog over a river with a so effective, very simple and effective, I would say. So in Chinese painting, you can depict very complicated things like this, very in a very direct approach, without doing the shading, lighting. We can still see just using the concept of solid and void, or soft and hard in Western terms, right? Some softness it shows. So in the night of fog, you don't have to use dark. It could be very light. Against the dark mountain, this become a fog above water. It's so subtle, yeah. And his boat, yes, he draw this kind of on his trip in his sketchbook. And we have a collection today with all his sketches. I have collected many online. And that's his references. You know, he does this kind of boat. He draw from life in Canton and some area he traveled. He also lives in Hunan. He was originate from Hunan province, a very watery area with big lakes and rivers, and then moved to north. He lived, spent his last 30 some years in Beijing, where Ping was born, right? So he had developed this, he paint landscape basically to express his homesick. He paint a lot of scenery from his old, like this, old home. A bridge in water and then autumn foliage, very colorful. So his color is very different than traditional landscape painting. But he does use pure ink here, right, to kind of anchor the painting. This is also autumn scenery with a road or river. Not sure. Some buildings. Yeah, this is a pond, lotus pond. It's a, almost like a, you know, something between a flower painting and the landscape. And his bridge, look at that, so effective in the distant mountains. Yeah, it's beautiful. Yeah, that's the name, the inscription indicates the recipient, original recipient, Zilin Renxiong, that's a doctor. Yeah. And he inscribed on every painting his poem. So he's a great calligrapher and also a seal engraving artist, just like his mentor, Wu Changshuo. We talked about Wu Changshuo earlier in this class. From Shanghai, right? I think they never met through a middle person, Chen Banding. He was introduced to Wu Changshuo and then saw Wu Changshuo's work because Chen was a student of Wu Changshuo and lived in Beijing and become his first mentor. He does Wu Changshuo style painting. And Wu Changshuo was known as a painter, as he himself put it, he painted qi without painting, drawing the xing or the form. So his paintings portray the qi of things, not the form, not depicting the form. Yeah. So qi has to do with breath, you know, the rhythm of breath. You know, the dense, sparse here, you can see that. And the S-shaped kind of movement, right? Right. This house is, yeah, I was interested to teach, to learn painting one of these the houses and the fence. That's a good example. It's like a village. And this one is a willow tree with this southern style mountain hemp fiber, hemp stroke for earthen mountains without you know, the rocks. It doesn't do much the northern style. So this is a literati style. This depicting the snow covered, I think this is outside the 12 scrolls, I think. This is something else. Anyway, it's a winter scenery. Okay, this is the picture of the city of Guilin in it's in Guizhou, right? Is it Guizhou or Yunnan? I forgot. Guangxi province, yeah. Guangxi, sorry. Yeah, this is Duxiefeng of Guangxi, Guilin. Yeah, Guilin. I think many of you probably heard or have even visited the place. One of our students, Lisa from Australia, lived there for a year, studied Chinese language. And she, in the first week, she climbed to the top of a mountain and showed us her sketch. That's, some like a small version of the scrolls. We thought, you know, you can do the same element with a in very small scale. That's what we could do in this class. So here's the sunset or sunrise, maybe a sunrise picture on the right bottom, and the moon on the corner. Yeah, this is the picture we are going to. Okay, let me stop sharing. Okay, time to paint, right? So we almost spent half time doing the reviews. I will show you one last thing just to test your eye. So let's see if we already developed some familiarity of Qi Baishi's art. So when we spot something, we can tell if it's real or not real, that from Qi. You know, if you are familiar with someone, you can tell if it's a Ping or Victoria from 100 yards away. You don't have to see details, right? Because we can see the qi of the person. All right. So if we look at some painting like this, do you see that? Okay, let me just put it on my left corner here. Okay, here. Yeah, okay, look at this small picture, then I'll show you details. Does it look like Qi Baishi? Don't look at the signature. It is attributed to Qi Baishi. But you have to tell us why you think it's not, why is something wrong? Then when we do it, we try to avoid that. So we'll make authentic copies, okay? First of all, from style. Go ahead.
Yeah, from style, one of the things I noticed is he doesn't have the, that painting doesn't have the, what do you call it, the dragon spine, like Qi Baishi always has in his. This one doesn't have that same kind of flow to it.
Yeah, I think so. That the mountain behind looks a little bit wild,
right?
Chaotic, yeah.
Yeah,
Qi Baishi wouldn't do that. I agree. And anything else? If you look at the detail now, we can. As I talked, you know, his stroke.
I don't think the strokes look very, very definite, you know, very sure. The way Qi Baishi's strokes are just so
clear.
Yeah, like forceful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is more like a Fu Bao Shi, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, so it's impossible for Qi Baishi to use a split brush, but sometimes you will see something like that. But it's within the limit of classic formation of rocks. Yeah, so you got a good point. Yeah, this is just a student work. I was a student level work. I don't know if it's, but you know, this one was featured in a very good article on Qi Baishi. So that's very ironical, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Henry?
Yeah.
Didn't he, with soft heels, didn't he like to use that hemp? And I'm not seeing any of that in the soft heels. The hemp lines or whatever they're called, hemp fiber.
Yeah.
I don't see any of it in those soft heels.
In this painting, we don't see any.
Correct. Yeah.
Yeah. So he, this wrinkle stroke is not Qi Baishi's at all. Yeah. That's it. So that's impossible. And all the other arrangement of the things, you know, let's go to see an authentic one, which is probably this painting was based on. let's compare. I sent you two paintings in the handout. Originally, I was thinking to do this study, and at first glance, I think the faked one was good for the class, because it's student work to begin with, I think. No. But I didn't realize it was a fake until I tried to find, when I look at the details and try to find the source of the, I realized it was a fake. Anyway, so we should not copy that, but it's a good teaching tool. This is the original, one of the original paintings. I saw this original painting in another book I have here. It's from the collection of the provincial painting in the museum, provincial museum of Hunan province, his hometown. It was an exhibition in Bao library in Anaheim in Orange County, in LA. This picture I was taken from this book actually. So you can see his real work of a house and a fence. He did the chicks. This is another sample. I believe this is probably a real one. It has an inscription to another classmate, maybe of Pin's mother. I think if you can recognize the name, I really don't know. It was given to Shang Qian. I don't know if Shang Qian Li Jizi. Another in a group picture, we see like five of them, right? Some they are all ladies. So I don't know who's Shang Qian Li Jizi. I didn't really research into that. But anyway, this one is very not that bad. I think it's probably a real copy, but I'm not sure. I think it looks more real. Yeah. Anyway, so but this color is kind of heavy. I thought a little. I have a little doubt, but this calligraphy looks. Yeah, calligraphy is easy to copy and even seal, using modern technology these days. Anyway, he has done many of this old house in his memory. This is a memorial, I think probably rebuilt, but this is the site for his bone place. Okay, it looks like Mao Zedong's. Yes, they are countrymen. They both from Hunan province, probably pretty nearby counties. So this looks more like a Mao Zedong's original house. Also look like this. So this is the real kind of building. He had lived in his young age, and later he repeatedly painted this when he was living in Beijing as a visitor or guest. And I sent you this picture because I was thinking about doing this Tang Dynasty poem called this Homebound, Homecoming. Yeah. It says, when I left home, I left home when I was young. Now I'm returning an old man. Children come to meet me or greet me. They took me cheerfully as a visitor and ask, guest, where are you coming from? So it's so moving. This poem was taught by my father when I was 3 years old. And he recited this repeatedly when he was you know, in his late age. And because he lived in Nanjing, and he was originally from Shaoxing, and another province. So this, you know, just make me feel homesick. I'm trying to do a painting based on several inspirations. If you like, you can do the ox. This is ox year. It's a good reason to do that. But maybe we're out of time to do the ox. So I'm going to make it simple for you. Just do a painting like a simple house with a visiting homebound guest. Okay. So I'm going to make a horizontal painting shown on this on the left. And I will change the setting of this house a little bit to with this one I sent you. Okay. I think this is doable within 1 hour. Are you ready?
Yep.
Okay. So we'll use a combination brush to do the outline. You can use a stiff brush also if you like. The reason I use combination brush is because this brush holds more ink, so I don't have to. On an absorbent paper, I use a unsized paper. It's a Red Star Shan, because Qi Baishi used this kind of paper. He made this paper very popular. Before him, in Republic of China, not many artists use them, because they're, first of all, cheap to get at that time, in Qi Baishi's time. So, and also he developed a style which take advantage of the absorbency and the watermark. Because when he does the shrimp, he used that watermark to make it look transparent, translucent, without outlining, you know, create this kind of. So you can use a charcoal to make a sketch of this house, roughly, let me tell you, lower than half. So this is the half mark. So there's two houses. We can do the main one lower than the half right here on the corner. So what about this? I just hide the top parts. Okay. Oops. Okay. So you don't need to paint the tall mountains. Okay. You can, if you like, you can draw the other house as well. It's almost like one line all the way down, and then to simplify it, you know. I think it goes right outside. So it's good to draw this. So you make mistakes, you can dust it off. Don't paint it too big, otherwise the figure has to be too big. So I have to redo this. Let's just draw a control line like that, and then something like that. And that's all. And maybe this is much. could be smaller. I still think it's too big.
Henry, could you move up the painting so that we could see the figure a little bit better?
Move up. You don't
Henry, did you send us the original painting?
Yeah, I did send the painting to you with 20 minutes before the class.
Thank you.
Yeah, you can use that as a reference. So let me enlarge this just like that. Maybe a little bit. We just concentrate on this corner, but don't do it too big. Leave a lot of room for landscape, this landscape class, okay. If you will, we can do the landscape first, but I think this house should come first. Yeah, and then we do the figure. The background will be last. So I'm going to draw this with ink. I just put the ink on my paper. A little bit dangerous, but I need to get some more ink here. Yeah. The line, the outline is kind of dark, but not so black. There's a big gradation. I believe the bottom of the brush is still light, right? As we usually do, and then the tip of the brush is dark. So we start from this front corner. And you can see it's darkest, and then it will become lighter and lighter, but not so light. So we don't need to reload, hopefully. So I just make a medium dark to a darker medium or something like that. But it should be a little quite dark to begin with. So I dip a little dark. So let's do a triangle first. Just a simple triangle, not very complicated. But I think this line is important. I want to make the this line is longer than the other line, all the other lines. It doesn't matter the perspective line is wrong or not. This ridge, the roof, is the longest. Otherwise, the house would not have enough room. It would look even more stranger. So this is the reason Shibaishi always does his utensils, his houses, with this kind of psychological truth. So it has a flat foundation. See, I my mind just made another kind of mistake. So it's kind of subtle. If you think anything, in Western painting, you will see that side, right? Can I make it up? I'm not sure. So I have to use my other side of the brain to mix that, because that's just the difference of generation. I think it just my subconscious won't follow I do have to make up the other side of the roof somehow, but I think maybe I was wrong. If I stand on this side, on the right side, I should see a little bit that, but if I stand on the left side, I shouldn't see this side, right? So I start to fix things. So this is not an exact copy of Qi Baishi. So this line should be going like straight up, but you don't have to, because in Chinese perspective, our eyes are moving, from one point to another. So if you fix on one point, that's Western perspective. So the major difference between Chinese landscape and the scenery, Western scientific scenery, not the Picasso or modern artist, you don't move your viewpoint in one painting; it's fixed. But in Chinese painting, in Chinese traditional landscape, you do move your eye. I think you can do it like one row at a time or just crossing. I'm not sure he did. He probably did the one. I just try to simplify. In some books, you will learn that, you know, they have curved up or curved down. The northern place in China is less rain, so the tiles are put with a upward curve. The in the south it's kind of downward. I think in this painting, in many of his paintings, including the 12 landscape scrolls, I see that the tiles are laid upside down. In my hometown, I used to live in an old house like with this kind of tiles when I was a child. So this really makes me think of that. I just make it straight, so it doesn't have to tell if it's a, and I'm probably more concerned with the pictorial logic, you know, like when I recede, I put less firmity, or what do you call this, solidness, and then more loose, yeah, when I paint. And you can leave some broken tiles, you know, just this is my mistake, but don't copy me. Maybe I could find an example that it does have this kind of perspective, right? Anyway, I'm going to do this one correctly. So I think he combines shapes pretty well. Like this line kind of continues into that side wall. And this almost parallel, but with a little bit changed. So it's not a straight line. And you hold the brush like this, like Chibaishi does, if you want to really make that. You can have a little bit pause in the middle or somewhere just to vary the rhythm a little bit, even a little change of direction. I thought too he was painting up. It could be down, it could bend it down a little bit and on the roof, you know, somehow. So, and this wall don't have to be straight, but the gravity has to be like that. You know, our patio poles is not straight either. Someone suggests to support it, to make it straight. I thought it's more artistic this way. As long as it doesn't fail, you know. Okay, and I will draw this window. And there's no window on this, but I do see, here's usually you see a corner of the interior. I'm not sure if this is, you know, this one could be a fake, but I cannot tell from this small. You have to tell from the cheek. It's kind of very good copy, I'll say. Okay, it should be. Let's just do a slant that represented the sidewall on the right, right? It could be. You could also see something. Let me look at some other examples. I don't want to make a mistake. Okay, just a slant usually. Yeah, I'm looking at another example here. we can just browse through maybe. Okay, don't fuss with that. Just make a slant which represents the, so it if you look at it through the wall, you will see a line parallel to the left. So from this corner, that's about it. You understand? You don't have to do anything else. There's some windows in at the back wall. You're probably not seeing it, but if you want, you can put a little bit, you know, just like indicate the standing wall, the back wall. Actually, this should be the side wall. Okay, don't fuss with that. It could be a window or something. The window has to be parallel to the, so just a little bit detailed, you know, maybe some dry brush without doing any, if you're not sure, leave it out. If you're not sure, leave it out. Yeah. If you're not sure, your audience will be confused. So, okay, some curtain like this. I think, let's finish the tile. And I draw this line first. They're basically parallel lines, but he does it just so, neat, right? Yeah, just draw them. And then add the tiles like that. Either upward or downward curve, but or straight, but you cannot confuse them. Sometimes up, sometimes down, sometimes straight. That's what I did in the beginning. So you'll say, oh, this is a fake, because Shibashi will never do that. Yeah, that's true. I don't want to really fake it. If you keep doing this, it will become, the brush will become drier and lighter maybe. So it just follow this sequence and you would have some kind of variation. Okay, just like that. Yes, some areas is denser, some, you know, with some whiteness, some of that. You can start to wash it, especially if you're not if your stroke is not so good. I can use even darker ink, so it will kind of cover up. But he does not do it in one stroke. He just do it one column at a time. So, and leave some highlight. Yeah, you don't have to do some dense part already kind of washed. So just blur it a little bit like that. So nobody will really see your weak strokes this way. My weak strokes. So just become a block. But with some breaths, we talk about breaths, some little bits of unpainted pockets of paper, it giving the painting some breath. You should vary the value of your ink wash from the ink stroke, so they don't, it's basically, yeah, two different layers, values. Yeah, and we don't really do the eve shadow, but there's some blur. I don't think it's original, but you know, it's very, very contemporary. You can do that. You can add, don't make it like a shadow, but you know, for those who are trained in Western tradition, you will look for some shadow there. But let me just give those audience a little bit teaser, you know, just a show them, oh, I know there's a shadow, but I don't really want to emphasize on that. You know, just this kind of, yeah, you can wash the ground because this is in shade. Yeah. But make sure it's not using a blotting paper to stop the blur. You know, if you think it's too much blurry, just blot it using a paper towel or something. If it's too smooth, I want it a little bit to break that a little bit, and then stop it. So don't make it like a mistake. Yeah, it could be overdone. So if you make everywhere blow like this, it will look too soft. Yeah, no good to do that. No reason to do that. Yeah, don't try to deliberate. I mean, if this happens, it's good. If it doesn't happen, don't try to make it. If you try to make it like I did, it will make it look unnatural. See the blur on this side is unwanted. Right? You want to keep that area to like a clean triangle or something like that. But that's just a learning curve, you know. I'm going to use a big brush to draw the, or should I do the figure before I do the ground? I think maybe the ground the last. So I'll draw this figure. you can draw the figure later. Maybe we set the landscape. Yeah. If you will, you can do the figure because this is a really important part. Let's do. You can add the fence if you like. It will be interesting, huh? So let's say if we have time, we'll do the fence. I'll make a fence. Let me see. Okay, I'll make a fence gate here. Just using the reference we have. But the direction is not correct. I have to create one. So basically, it's just like a three pole, two poles. You know that it's a little bit bigger than the gate. The entrance of the house. So let's just do. Okay, here's the story, a decision we have to make. First is the guest enter inside the gate or outside the gate? He was greeted inside in the yard, I think. Does that makes more sense? So the gate was behind him, right? Okay, let me show you the reference here. Okay, that's the, oops. Okay, this is the picture I tried to use as a copy, but we have to change the direction a little bit. I'm thinking the guest already entered the home, so it will be maybe somewhere here. Outside the picture, maybe. I'll just do it this way. It should not in the center, so it should be maybe. A good master always taking advantage of the edge and the corner. So let's do it this way on this corner, maybe. I'll do it on the corner. This corner was originally empty, so I'll do it like that. I just have to take some risk. Let me see. So I use lighter ink. I don't want to emphasize on that, but this gate is has to be certain. So I have to use a little darker ink. And that it could be slant a little bit. like that, and just you do a one horizontal on top of a vertical, right? This could be should be longer, and then the gate was opened, so you can have a gate open like that, okay? And you put a bar and some verticals, and this one. Oops. I just realized that my width is too narrow, so I just omit this half. So it should be. He did this gate like half open, so I didn't have space. If I do that, it will have a narrow opening. So I want to keep that door open. So maybe I just make it foreshortened. Yeah, Western perspective. So what? Maybe you can see a little bit top. I'm not sure. And then just do a horizontal and then the vertical. Because I feel the horizontal set you can do something like that, set the heights and direction, and then you do the bars. Actually, they are made of bamboo, so you can vary you can make a stop with a joint. If you don't have time, if we don't have time, just do it straight. Maybe you do a few with bamboo, not bamboo joints to indicate that, and then just simplify the rest. Okay, so this side goes out of the picture. Then you have to come back. I think I'm too ambitious today. I tried to combine several paintings, try to create a story of home visit. So I will use some bamboo, maybe cover this corner later. So we can basically, you can do some kind of, oops, this should be lower. Another mistake. See, the logic is the fence should be lower than the house, no matter what. Yeah. Okay, that's we may add something in the back to cover that line. And then you can have something between. See, I start drafting. That's losing patience. So Chibashi would never have something like that because I didn't have a sketch, a plan to start with. So we are kind of making up things in the beginning. So this creates some kind of lost and found kind of fence. That's what I try to do. Okay, now we can have a little children in the yard. Okay, I'll do this background with the pine, just like this. So it will be pine and some bamboo, under the pine should be fine. So I'm going to make some pine trunks with a darker gray. And then we dot the pine needles in what we call the toothbrush side. So first of all, there are actually some light, some dark. So hold the brush straight and just make some grouping, I think when we paint the trunk, the main thing we consider is the plan. So some in the back the root should be higher. So let's do the front first. I'll just make it. Should I do another house just behind here? Maybe a neighboring house. I don't know. We just try. So a slant one, a straight one, and a short one. This one coming from outside. This one. There will be a bamboo growth around the house. So bamboo, this trunk, this pine is a little away from the house. That's okay. And I will do some more here. Maybe we'll do one more here. And there's a curve on this side. So this is a less group. This is three, this is two. That's good. Okay, so we make this higher. This is in the main, and this is in the front. So some overlapping created depths. Yeah. Okay, this is this is just we can have some tree here, just at the top and the bottom will be bamboo leaves, bamboo growth, and some maybe someone like that, and just some short ones. These are the branches. Okay, I'm doing because I do one thing at a time, so it create a pattern. Create a pattern of a chi. Okay, so if this looks fine, you just vary a little bit. You know, you can modify that, and then I will start with the main one again with a dark stroke, dark brush, and just do this. Dot, 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 above the brush handle, right? So, and you can leave some space in between. The dark first, the light, and the wash later. So just create a rhythm of dots. Yeah, this is similar to Fu Baoshi's approach, yeah. But without using the split brush, this is kind of split. The Fu Baoshi should not really invented everything, right? Just more chaotic sometimes, more poetic, if you will. More talented to control to turn chaos into order. Okay. And if you add water, just without adding ink, it will become lighter. Okay, just use so I flatten the brush, like you can flat it with your finger, but it'll make the finger dark. So I just flat it on the palette, just like this. You know, make it flat, yeah. Then use the flat side, not the chisel side, to do this. And you can keep that shape. That's the way of using the brush. It's not, you know, some brush is flat, some brush is round. They are all round brush. I always have Western watercolor painter asking me to watch this video of the artist using a Chinese brush, but his brush is flat. Do you sell that kind of brush? No, I said, you have to learn the way, you know, how to use it. That's the Chinese brush, calligraphy brush is made to do everything, not just one thing, you know, like a flat brush or round brush. There's not no different. Okay, so that's my, it's a little bit too high. I think for the mountain, okay, let's see. After it dries, maybe when it's halfway dry, we'll start to wash. So the dots will have some blur into the, we can have a medium dots and then the indigo wash for that. And then while we wait this to dry, we will do the figures. Okay, we can use a small brush. I just use this pointed brush for that. You can use a tiny little brush, detail brush, if you will. Let me change the reference to that figure. Where's my figure? Okay, here. Enlarge it so you can see. First of all, this visitor just coming in here. Okay, he's wearing a hat, so we don't really tell he's bald or not. He's bald, like me. So the accent unchanged, my hair grows thin. That's the point poem says. So yeah, but anyway, it could sometimes people translate as my hair turns gray. It depends on your age, you know. You can translate differently. So he's holding a walking stick that indicates he's an old man. He's coming in like that. I feel the figure is not so well done with the posture is not so. It's so still. And anyway, so this little children is running, kind of. It's welcoming. Yeah, it should be a little bit active, showing hospitality or something. Wearing a large clothing, because usually when we are young, we always given large clothing. Because we grow so fast, right? That makes it looks like church. Anyway, I'm not really depicting anything, just the impression. Okay. Just a little figure and a larger figure, and then we will color it. Or you can leave it. Let me see, a little blue may be good to contrast with the ground. So we can use just a little bit green, I mean indigo. Yeah, but not too much. So very pale. And then I use a little amber for the face. And then we don't really see the hand, but you can do a little bit. And the face of the children, and this is a girl or a boy, I don't know, but we'll do it with a red. See, or orange color, maybe a little. Some yellow, neat. Yellow and red makes orange. Just use something here. Just a little color is needed. And yeah, that's it. You can leave the pants white or yeah. So. You can do a little wash on the fence with some green. It's a bamboo fence, so some kind of just ink, light ink is fine. Just to blend a little bit. Okay, I will do some bamboo if we have time. You can spend lots of time on that. And if you don't have time, just to omit that, maybe. You can do a few, let's just show you how to do it. So you can you can paint some branches, very thin. Well, we don't really have to do that much here. Just the little character kind of. It could be very loose, you know, we're leaving a lot of space for just a symbol, just like writing the character bamboo. Yeah, it's almost like that bamboo, you know, bamboo. This is bamboo. So that we know that's bamboo, just like writing notes on the trip, you know, like Fubashi or Chibashi also does this. You can just write a word bamboo there. And you can have some, you know, just plants or something. They overlap with some fence. Bamboo itself makes a good fence, by the way. And on in the front, you can have a little more detail, you know, even like joints or something. But he would never do something like I'm doing too drafty. So you keep it in a group of three, just like writing the character. Just writing the character small, it also sometimes look like a bamboo. Yeah, the character is small. Just write a lot of character small or good individual. You can have some inside maybe as well. Don't have to be outside. And I think these are important pointers, like pointing the viewer's attention back to the host, the focal point. That's why I'm doing this. Yeah, we have bamboo in our home, just grow like that. But it's brick wall, you know. The other day we had a squirrel eating the bamboo on the wall, on the, eating the whole bamboo stem, the young grow bamboo stem, like a sugar cane. Okay, that's about it. We can wash the back, the ground, and then the mountain, the last, and the sky. Okay, I'll use the large brush. You can use the super wash brush. Let me see. Super wash. So like this guy's. So this is among the five basics. Okay, I'm gonna soak it. Make sure you soak it first. And then I use umber chips. That's what the chip I should use. I should have this soaked it earlier. And you can add a little bit of indigo to mute it, or a little ink. I'll just make a, and we need a lot of them, so you can prepare a lot with a saucer or something. You can use tube. Oops, I already got on the paper here. Happy accident. Okay, that's good. And I hope I can do it with one load. A little bit ink, maybe some to start with. Okay, so this corner, just like that. And you lift towards the center, so it's kind of, the reason is to show the white wall, right? This is start from the wall. So you it smears, so you cannot hesitate. Just hold your breath when you do it. Just like that. And you should avoid the figure, so that's kind of created this stage. But if it's, I just covered it, that's okay. There's a shadow. Yeah, there's a shadow. Good, good. There was always some reason, huh, for the mistakes. And we just watch the fence with the same color. Okay. Soft brush, yeah. Soft brush. So this is the ground. Well, I think there should be some kind of trail. Could be. Just kind of suggestive. Okay. And then I wash the bamboo fence. Let me see what. Yeah, I think just use this color because you just see through the color of the ground is fine. And just make it simple, you know, not use too much color, just similar color with same, it's fine. I just add a little variation. You can add a little yellow somehow. Oops, I got some red, that's fine. So some yellow, some red variation is good. Make this gate a little red, because it might have some spring couplet or something on it, leftover or something on it. It's okay. And then you can blot it if it starts to smear. Okay, the bamboo growth, I use a yellow and the indigo to create a green. And maybe we can just blend it on the paper. So I just wash yellow, just dab. And vary the density or height. And then I add little indigo. So it become green. And I just dab a little bit large and the medium or small in the shady part. Maybe, oops, that's too dense. Okay, this shady part. Around the house is more shady with the trees, under the trees, a little bit more there, and this is more. Something like that. Okay, then we can create a little more ground outside. So maybe there's a slope or something that gives the ground for this tree also, and it goes up maybe like that. And there's no more on this side. So maybe a hill top behind the tree, just like that. Yeah, we call this a nongmai, right? You guys know the dragon land, the ridge. It's there. So the pine tree is a okay. I think we're still missing one layer, so I need to make it up. Maybe I was too late to add, but it's okay. I just add a little medium to the dark to add a little more depth to the tree before I paint the color. It should have a medium tone, maybe. Medium. It's a little football shiggish. Okay. Oops. Yeah, I think you should do the toothbrush all the way. So do not try to vary the stroke. Just to keep that kind of stroke. So just dot the trees, even the color part. Yeah. Add some blue to the ink. So we'll create evergreen kind of, bamboo is also evergreen. I know many of my overseas Chinese customers, they don't like dark ink at all. They like everything green. But yeah, this is a copy of Qi Bai Shi. So we try to do the authentic way. Otherwise, you can use brown in the trunk and then dark green instead of black. But I try to keep the classic way doing this. Here I'm using very dramatic colors. I'm going to use some Western color, the sienna, burnt sienna, with a yellow for the background. Let me show you. I got some burnt sienna. It's dried up, so I just recycled it. Because this is a more, it's a little different than the ground, than the amber. It's mild. Let me try to create a very strong. You can use a, you can use vermilion with some amber and the yellow, maybe, to create a kind of warm. I try to use this color. Actually, this print may be overemphasized. Let me show you. We have two versions for the color. One is this one is strong, too strong, maybe. This one actually is a picture of original painting, I think, yeah, without editing that much. It's also very warm, very red. So that's why I use a more reddish burnt sienna in this. And this kind of granation because the color is dried. So let me do this, see how it looks like. I want to make sure I got enough water. So I just add some water to the heel of the brush with a clean brush. So I'm ready to go. You can start from the top. Use the side of the brush. Try to hide the tip along the way, yeah, on the top. So you can do it like that. Think about a groove. It's a group of strokes. And you just follow that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And just roll the brush to finish. So I try to keep that top kind of like a greening landscape we talked about. Yeah, you can add a little more water. I see the smear like that. You can press more to use the heel of the brush, and you overlap a little bit with the pine. It's fine. You can leave some white under it, soften. That's also perfect. Okay. The key is you cannot really. Keep doing that. It starts to blur. You need to do this, just like it has, you know, the shrimp are added. that's the key to use this kind of paper. Otherwise, you will blur too much. Okay. One last stroke. It's an indigo. Oh, you can use a little bit mineral blue with that, but I think we only have 1 minute, so I'll do whatever I have here. So I got a little bit of ink left over. That's good to make it a little muted and a little bit brown coming in to make it green. Is that good? No, I'll keep that away. And I touch a little bit more indigo and then blend a little darker. So it will be, let me show you the strong version. This one is clear, but maybe too strong. It's the same picture, but enhanced with a photograph, different photography. So I'm going to do this one is the major one. This is the distant one. Okay, maybe you want to see this one. It's smaller too, so just like that. And try to combine them, that's the challenge. Let me see, maybe we can make another stroke like that. It's a little far than the original. So, yeah, I think it's okay. We can, if we don't like the white, yeah, what we do, just put some blue there so it looks like behind. But there's a yellow mountain, yeah. But don't worry about the what's behind. It's in this sense, you know, just soft, yeah. Blood. Stop. If this confined area is too stiff, we can use some water to soften it. Yeah, just drop of water. That's the trick to make the stiffness soften. But don't manipulate it too much. Sometimes it's good to have, you know, just don't interfere too much. And some outer edge needs to change a little bit, you know, just like this part, it doesn't, it has a concentration. I need to kind of disperse a little bit with the outer shape. Okay, and that's about it. You can add more ink, what they call this, letters, the characters, if you want. If you have time, you can just fill it up with. And you can still change the tone. The bamboo does look very yellow in the sunshine, you know, or in certain stage for growing. I like that. It's kind of vibrant. I see a little bit yellow in this picture that's shining through, look like backlit. I have some white there, is probably enough. If not, you know, after it dries, I will add a little yellow just to indicate a backlit effect. But right now I don't want to touch it because it's going to disappear to blur. So I just keep that eye. It's another chi eye. You see that? That created the, you know, just break this dense area. See that yellow? Let me enlarge it. You see that yellow? It's pure yellow through the whole of the tree, looking at some sunshine there. I don't know if this one is authentic or not, but it's looks a good copy, good painting. Okay, I missed an area here. I need to make it up. Some bamboo. Okay. Oops. Okay, time to describe. It's 11:33. If you have other things, you may leave. I'll send you the recording after that. But if you have time, I will show you the title part. He signed on this corner. I think we have more room on this side. So either we should start from here. Maybe we can go all the way around if we want to copy the whole poem. I probably just write to shorten the to make reference to the poem we inspired, you know, to add a dimension to the painting. You can refer to the title or the author of the book of the poem, or you can just write a Tom poem, something like that. Let me just write the first line. 少小离家老大回, I left home when young. Now I'm returning when old. Now I return when old. Yeah. 少小离家老大回. Okay, it's a simple character to write. Can you see this corner? Okay. Shao means young, Shao means youngster. Li Jia. Shao Xiao Li Jia. Li left home. Lao Da Hui. Returning Lao Da means senior. Left home young, a youngster, returning a senior. We are all seniors now. I just realized I bought a senior ticket for the first time in my life when we visited the LA Zoo a few weeks ago to study tiger for the tiger year. 少小离家老大回. Should I write the whole poem? Probably not. I just don't have time. So I'll just say, 致敬齐白石, okay? Homage to 齐白石, and then my signature. Unless you really, you know, write a good calligraphy, don't try to write long inscriptions. You ruin your painting. Some of the students in Victoria's class are doing very well with their calligraphy. I really admire. 致敬齐白石. I'll just write the 致敬白石 maybe. 白石翁. Yeah, that's what he called himself. Yeah. Master Xi Baishi, okay. He called himself like old man. Reference. Yeah, also, we call someone old master. Baishi Wong is old master. Baishi Wong, from Baishi Wong. Xinchou. The year of ox. Xiao Hui, my Chinese name. Okay, and then signature, I mean seal. I just stretch the paper and then press gently, so I don't need to put in the pad at the same time. Okay. If you, well, you still, you know, can make up some last touches, but I think we're pretty good with this. And if you want, you can highlight a little bit brown, maybe on the side wall or somewhere with just a little touch of a warm, a little color. I'm not sure if he does that, but the modern artists always just a little bit highlights on the lines. Let's see. And also on this beam. Okay, that's my tribute to Qi Baishi. And I thank again for your patience and your participation. I thank especially our whole co-host today, Ping, for sharing her mother's wonderful learning experience and life experience with Qi Baishi. Any comments? Any critique? Maybe let's see. Okay, someone left earlier. That's okay. Yeah, there are some comments in the chat. I'll send you the recording that has the chat downloadable. I mean, yeah, you can download the link to purchase the book on Amazon, right? There's a link being posted to purchase this beautiful book by her mother. That's the title of it. The paintings of Guo Xiuyi, G-U-O-X-I-U-Y-I. And wish we had time to do the arcs. Maybe you should do that on your own, and I will be very happy to see them in a regular online class. Okay, any questions, any comments before we call off? You can unmute yourself. Are you following me today? Because I think it's very challenge to compose a painting without planning ahead. It's all with the inspiration of Qi Baishi's wonderful life and the painting and the Tang Dynasty poem that I learned from my parents. So it just make me homesick and feel the drive to do this. I hope you enjoyed. It should be in the series of home memory. I regret I didn't do it. Sorry if Yongle is looking at this, watching this next time. So maybe, yeah, we'll do it again.
Thank you so much, Henry. It was great.
Thank you.
Thank you, Henry. It was really, it was very informative. Very great. Thank you, Ping, too.
Thank you for all the extra stories and things. That's really, really so wonderful. Really enjoyed it.
That's what makes it so wonderful.
Yeah.
Well, and I think it's very helpful to watch you create and of complete painting. And hearing your thoughts and thinking it through is very helpful to me.
Yeah, I agree. Yes.
That's good. Great. I'm not going to touch it anymore. Just leave it.
I also like the idea we're not copying the exact painting.
Right.
You change it, and that's great.
Yeah, I think that's a good way to learn. Just copy, recompose with right. elements, learn from the different. So you are still the master style. Of the tech architecture. Right. Yeah. Right. So you're the designer. You just use the element from the masters.
Right.
Yeah. That's a very, very good way to do. Just learn and then try to put them together. So you learn composition from one, different elements from other. So yeah, that's great.
Okay.
Oh, Qi Baishi has lived a very long life, as the team mentioned. And he lived till 95, almost 95, right? So he painted all the way to his last day. So painting actually is, he has a seal says, Ren Chang Shou. That's his, the function of painting or art. He does seal engraving and calligraphy, poetry, writing, essays, beautiful articles. So I hope we, you know, not only learn his art techniques, but also learn his life. He had a son born at age of 72, I think.
Wow.
Yeah, he married three times, maybe two, I forget. Anyway, so he had a wonderful fulfilled life as a human being, and very high quality work life with the painting and the art. So well, I wish all you healthy and happy painting. See you next time.
Great.
Thank you, Henry.
Thank you, Henry.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Thank you.